I continue to talk about missional community today and how important it is that every one of us has a mission to reach our community for Jesus. And that could be starting with your own home, it could be starting with people at work, anywhere, just as long as you're sharing Jesus to help people come to a greater knowledge of Him. And I want to start with a little story. There was a neighbor, a friend, that's doing this missional community. He has a neighbor named Tom, and Tom was not a believer, or not quite a believer. You know, was a churchgoer in the past. And he had been talking to him. They share lawn equipment, you know, blowers and stuff like that. And his daughter was going to get baptized in a few weeks. He wanted to invite his friend Tom to go to the baptism so he can learn about baptism. It's a special event. Maybe he can tell him, you know, maybe he'll come to church that day. They had a pretty good relationship. And so they were talking, and he said, "Have you ever been baptized?" He goes, "Yeah, I was baptized a long time ago. They put a white robe on me. It was up in the choir loft. They dunked me underwater, and that was about it." And he probably hadn't been to church ever since. And so his relationship with God wasn't so hot. But anyway, he didn't understand. And the gentleman says, his name was Nick. Nick says, "Well, you know, when I got baptized, I really didn't understand what baptism was." And most of us, you know, get baptized and we want to do that because we're being obedient to what Jesus told us to do, but don't really understand the importance of it and the depth of it. And so I want to read this verse. And my son Andrew preached on this in Matthew 28. If you want to turn there, Matthew 28, verse 16. He said, this is, now my Bible says the Great Commission. And when Andrew, my son, preached it, he said the Great Recommission. And, well, I won't explain all that. You can watch the tape online of what he said. But the point is that we're reemphasizing what God told us to do back in the beginning. So anyway, it says here, it says, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him," are you all there? Matthew chapter 28, and verse 16. Let's wait till I hear the iPads. iPhone, everybody got it. Okay, we're there. Okay, good. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, and they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and earth have been given to me. Therefore," now all authority is given to Jesus. "It is therefore, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very ends of the age." And so he was telling his friend that when my daughter gets baptized, she's getting baptized into the family of God, the Father. The Father represents the family. So now we're baptized into his family. Then she's baptized in the name of Jesus. Why? Because Jesus is now King and Lord over her life. Amen. So in the name of the Father, I now have a new family. Matter of fact, for us that didn't have a very good earthly father, I now have a perfect father. God the Father, we're baptized into the family of God. And then she is saying, why she gets baptized, "I'm now baptized in the name of Jesus. I'm going to make Jesus the Lord of my life." Maybe that song we sang earlier is really appropriate. "I surrender all to Jesus because I give him supreme authority over everything in my life." Can you say amen? Or oh me? Either one works. What's cool is, it says previously before that, some doubted, even disciples at that point had a little doubt. "Lord, help my unbelief that I might believe in him." Amen? So then he also said, "You're baptized in the Holy Spirit." So Father, you're baptized in the family. The Son, you give him supreme authority, or we'll talk about service in just a few minutes. And then the Holy Spirit, you're baptized in the name of the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit has a new purpose for your life. Amen? When I'm baptized, I surrender all to Jesus. So now I have nothing of my own or no direction of my own. I have nothing that I can identify with because now I've given it all to Jesus. Come on. That's what it means. Maybe we all need to get rebaptized, huh? Because now you have a different mission in life. And the mission for every one of us is to share Jesus with the world. Amen? And we'll talk about that a little more in a little bit. So we have a different identity. We have a new family with the Father. We have a new purpose. We have a new King and Lord of our life through Jesus. And we have a new purpose through the Holy Spirit. Amen? And I have some questions here. We'll talk about them later. Let's talk about the Father for a moment. Is equaled or we're adopted into a new family. And I want to share a lot of scripture verses with you today to help you see that in the Word of God. Because we are, if you look at, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'll just hesitate for a second because I didn't want to, but just show you, I'm going to show you through scripture just how we are part of the same body and purpose. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is a chapter most of you know about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, right? But then down on verse 12, you go there, it says, the body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts, and though all its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ, for we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks. So that term, Jews or Greeks, are the Jews that we know are God's chosen people. Ever since the beginning, God chose them. They didn't exclude us. And so we're the Greek part. So that means every nation, just like it said in Matthew 28, all nations, all people will come to Jesus. And as slave or free, we are all given to one Spirit to drink. Now, and then it goes on to talk about the body, and everybody has a different purpose. So we're not all have the same purpose, but we're all one. Now, in the world standard, I was talking to somebody yesterday, and as we achieve things in life, we get really selfish, you know, and we start getting titles, you know, especially if you get like your doctorate, and you get two doctorates, then you really got respect in the world, right? So it's about our accomplishments and our achievements. But what we feel as Christians, what we struggle with is not, that's not our identity. Our identity is we're servants to everyone. So you can be the best whatever. You can be the best ditch digger, if you will. The best on the team. But your identity is not being a ditch digger. Your identity is you're a Christian. Amen? And you're part of a family that has that same identity. Let's jump over to 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 17. In this whole section, I'm one of those guys, I like to read the whole chapter, but I'm not going to do that today because I have a lot to go through. So write these down and please, or if you want my notes, I'll just give you, make copies of this afterwards because I want you to look this up and research this. But look at the first part of this section, chapter 2, talk about submitting yourselves to the Lord, say for every, to every authority instituted among men, whether to the king, or to the supreme authority, so on and so forth. Verse 14, go down to verse 17. It says, show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God and honor the king. So it shows that we're a brotherhood in this verse. We should love the brotherhood. So everybody here today should love each other. Why should we do that? Because what happens? When you're part of a family, how many know families, natural families kind of struggle? I'll be going to my sister's house this afternoon. Please pray for me. We are going to give God praise for bringing her out of the hospital so early. She had two flatline incidents in the hospital. She was on her deathbed and God raised her to life. And so I've been praying about that, and I'm like, what am I going to do? You know, I don't want to just let this now. Everybody in my family, most of them are nominal believers in Christ. So they'll acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God. But that's all. I'll talk about it a little bit too. as we talked about on Tuesday night, if you believe in Jesus, you're going to adapt and hear and you're going to be like him. It's more than just a mental assent that, yes, that's the Son of God. It's I'm surrendering all myself. When I'm baptized, I'm recognizing him as king of my life, and I'm giving it all to him. And so I'm going to be able to share today, hopefully, with the love of God, or all the love of the Father, and give him praise for what happened. And so I had this whole list of things I was writing out of what I was going to say to them, and then I just threw it in the garbage. Because the Lord told me, all you have to do is love them. So all I have to do is tell them the reason Paula is alive today is because God touched her, and let's give him praise. And whatever you're dealing with in your life today, I want to pray for you also. Amen. And so then we're just going to let it go like that and see what happens. I'm sure it'll be tons of questions. So will you pray for me that I have the wisdom of God? But I want to be this. I want to let them know that they're part of the family of God, and I got to love them. And then we love the world around us. What changes? When we have the love of the Father flowing through us, then that love flows to the family or the people outside the family of God. And it draws them to God through the Holy Spirit. But our responsibility is to love them. Oh, Lord, help us to love. Come on, say it with me. Help me to love more like the Father loves us. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 5:9. Let's jump over there. 5:9. It says, resist him. Let's talk about the devil here. This is the whole chapter. I don't want to take it out of context totally, but I just want to see that we're part of a family, a brotherhood. It says, be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. So that's what the devil's job is to try to mess you up. Can you say amen? All right, that's what he does. But I want you to know that he has no power over you if you're a believer. So he's going to try and mess you up. You have to recognize that he's there and then command him to leave in Jesus' name or flee a situation that is inappropriate. It says right here, verse 9, resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same type of suffering. So all over the world today, and let's just turn on the news and look at what's happening in Iraq right now, where all the Christians are being killed by the hundreds, just because, for only one reason. I mean, think about it. Loving, caring people, loving the community around them, and now they're being slaughtered because of only one reason, because they're a believer in Jesus Christ. So I'm thinking, the stuff I go through right now is nothing. I ain't going through nothing compared to what my brothers and sisters across the world is doing. Amen and pray for them. But we have a family, so stand up strong in knowing that the Father is there for you. Okay, let's do something a little more happier. Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. My title here is just pray for the Ephesians. For this reason, I kneel before the Father. So when we pray, who do we pray to? We pray to who? God the Father. In Jesus' name. And whatever you ask in Jesus' name, he'll do it for you if you believe. Hallelujah, that's powerful. So we're praying to kneel to the Father, before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and earth divides his name. So you have a new name. You have a different identity. You're a part of a family called believers. Amen. Jesus, God gave you that. So when we pray, everybody look at this. It says, I'm just reading the word of God here. Not, I didn't make this up. It says the whole family is all on heaven and earth. So we have family in heaven, and we have family on earth. Who's the family we have in heaven? We have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Well, how about all the angels that are around that we can't even see right now? They're called ministering angels. They come to minister to us. Oh, we know, I can't see that, so it's hard for me to believe. But the Bible tells us that we may be entertaining angels unaware, so that obviously they can thrill themselves to us. They're part of our family. Praise the Lord. God wants, see, God, when we are in this world, He didn't want us to be comfortless. He didn't want us to be weak. He wants us to be strong and mighty in Him. So He says, I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to send you another comforter. He's going to say, hey, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Well, I pray and I pray and my prayers aren't getting through. Well, we heard of Daniel. He prayed and prayed. Man, there's a big fight in heaven. And finally, the answer came. So you don't know when you're praying if the answer's coming or not. Just continue to pray. Hallelujah. We're in a fight. We're in a battle. This isn't easy. So the whole family in heaven and earth devise His name. I pray that out of His glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being. In your inner being. The Father wants to strengthen you. As we pray, we want to strengthen. When I pray for you, I want you to be strengthened in here. So what happens in here, in your inner being? What happens? How does the enemy attack you? It happens inside. Oh, I'm not really sure about that. I don't understand that. All of a sudden, fear comes in. All of a sudden, doubt comes in. And then we're not really walking the walk we're supposed to walk. Come on. Is it just me or is it just everybody? Right? Come on. We all do that. We need the strength because brothers and sisters in Christ are praying for each other, strengthening each other, encouraging each other, eating meals together, right? Just like Acts 2, coming together in His name, and so we can do this thing called life together in the power of the Holy Spirit. We're in a family called God. Look at Galatians, go back a chapter, a book, Galatians chapter 6, and verse 10. Talking about our family here. And, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. How many believers do I have here? Raise your hand up high. Do I have any believers in this place today? Okay, good. Then we should do and take care of each other. I love the young couples life group because they're always meeting together, they're always talking about stuff, talk about marriage, talk about raising kids, talk about drinking alcohol, they just talk about all sorts of stuff, right? I mean, it's what we're doing life together. It's nothing. That's what you should do, to encourage each other in the faith as you go on. If you're not part of a life group, you need to be part of a life group, amen? So we can be together more often. I'm coming to realization of this. I have to eat every day. Come on. I mean, especially if I don't eat breakfast or lunch, I'm definitely eating dinner. So I'm going to eat dinner. Why eat dinner alone? Why not just invite a neighbor to come over and have dinner? Man, that's a lot of work, Pastor. I got to clean my house. I got to do this. I got to do that. No, because their house is just as messy as your house. It's just life. I wasn't going to tell this story because I didn't know if they were coming today. But anyway, I'll tell the story now. So we have a friend come over the other day, right? And remember how I told you how sometimes we open up, we're talking about power and love, we go down the street, just talking to people and sharing Jesus with them. You see somebody with a crutch, obviously they have a sore leg, so you can go over and pray for them. It's really easy, right? You just share some love and pray for them. If God does a miracle, praise the Lord, it's great. So we had somebody come over to the house the other day, and they came to the house, they came in at 7:30, they didn't leave till 11. So I thought, you know, I mean, we talked about, Tina and I didn't say anything, but yeah, okay, oh, I'm sorry about that, you know? And for 4 hours or so, they threw up on us, told us all about their lives, all about their situations, everything about, I mean, all their problems. They needed somebody to talk to, I guess, you know? And so I didn't feel sorry for them, I was just listening, you know? And God just gave me revelation after revelation after revelation of what they need, you know? I didn't tell any of them that night. I didn't share anything with them because it wasn't the right time. But God has showed me through just being kind to them. And I said, Tina, wait, but a couple hours into it, I said, Tina, why don't you get some coffee? So I got coffee, you know? And we got to stay up a little later because we had a fresh cup of caffeine in us. And, you know, I don't want to fall asleep while we're talking. But the point is, we had to share their life because I just opened our house. Amen. It's what God wants. It's like being Jesus in our world. I want to challenge you to just be what God wants you to be, and don't do it because Pastor Bob said. But But it's more to life as a believer than just taking care of ourselves. Because if I surrender all, if I really believe what I sung earlier, then everything belongs to Jesus. And our purpose is to bring people closer to Him. Let's go to one more verse in this point here. Is 1 Thessalonians. And it's right after Colossians, right after Ephesians, Galatians, Colossians, Thessalonians. Just go to the towards Revelation there. Chapter 4. Matter of fact, this is a good book. Just read. Just get a fresh perspective of what God wants you to do. Verse 10. You know, this whole section is really, really good. It says, verse 1, finally, brothers, be instant, be instructed how you should live in order to please God as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus, do not do this more and more. And then jump down to verse 10. And in fact, you do love all the brothers throughout Macedonia. Yet we urge you, brothers, to do it more and more. And when I read that, I thought, I'm going to share that Sunday because I want you to understand that we should love each other more and more. Amen? So whatever that takes, we get the birthday reminders, right? You did all that. How many get three birthday reminders from the church? You should send a birthday card or an email at least to everybody. You know, invite them to dinner. Invite them to your home. And get to know the people that are here in this church right now. We're really small, so it's really easy. We can do that. When we get 1,000 people in this church, I still want that to happen. Love each other, because how can you love the world if we don't love each other? Husbands, love your wives. This is a good thing, right? The Bible says instructs us to do that, so we have to love our wives. Okay, I got that. All right, I love my children. I love my grandchildren. Oh, that's easy, you know? But how do I love my neighbor who's like totally different than me? How do I love that person? How do I invite that person to be part of the family that's going to strengthen them and really give them the gift of his salvation, the gift of eternal life? How do I do that? Because I have to love. I have to love first. So let's practice in here first. Right? Let's practice. In September, we're going to get a lot of new people come from, because of the university. We'll get more new people coming into church, right? So we need to, what's the best thing? When you have a new person come in, especially international, that's here for the very first time in a foreign country, in Madison, Wisconsin, and all of a sudden you make a friend right away. You are friends for life. I'm still connected with hundreds of people that have come here just through Facebook and through social media. Today, India, Pradeep from India, just emailed me,
Facebook.
Yeah, instant message me. So it's 3:00 in the morning there, and it's 11:00 here, and we're talking back and forth. I said, aren't you tired? Yeah, but I was just thinking about you, so I just want to say hi, you know, and saw me online. I said, well, hi, how you doing? So he's doing really good. Pray for me if we get a wife, he always says to me. He wants a wife, and he hasn't had a wife yet. He's like 32, so he, please pray. That's his number one prayer. So I pray with him to get a wife, right? Why not? But it's because we're family. We care about each other. Hallelujah. Number two, servant. Jesus, the Son of God, taught us this one lesson, probably the most important lesson he taught the disciples, and taught us that we are supposed to be servants, right? Servants to all. So this is, let's go to, in your Bible to John 13. That's where Jesus was washing the feet of the disciples. John 13. When Jesus was washing the feet of the disciples, right? And then Peter, the verse 8 says, and Peter says, no, you should never wash my feet. And Jesus said, unless I wash your feet, you have no part in me. Then the Lord said, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, wash my hands and my whole head as well. Jesus answered, a person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you, and he's talking about Judas. Verse 11, for he knew who was going to be betrayed, and that was why he said, not everyone is clean. When he had finished washing his feet, he put his clothes and returned to place, and says, verse 12, do you understand what I have done? He asked them, you call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for this is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you as an example that you should do what I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is the messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. So what was he talking about? He went to the Last Supper, the last gathering before he was going to be arrested and crucified, and he gave this example to the disciples. He washed their feet. That was a common practice in that day. When you walking down the dusty road, you come into a home, they had the lowest of the servants, the youngest of the servants, would be the one that would wash the feet of the people that were your guests at your home. Jesus took on that role. So it's more than just that Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, he took on the form of the lowest servant. He took on the form of the sacrificial lamb, if you will. He took on that form, the lowest, authority in the room, and he knelt down and he washed all their feet, even Judas' feet, because he wanted them to do the same thing. So what did he want? Did he want us to wash each other's feet in church? That would be cool, I guess. We could have a foot washing service. But he really wanted us to serve everyone. The authority is Jesus. It's not theirs. You're not greater than the messenger. You're not greater than Jesus. You're just the messenger. So we're going to share this message of hope, what's going to happen here shortly, that he was going to sacrifice his life to be the final sacrifice for sin for the whole world. And you're going to be the messenger, but you're not any greater than me. You're just going to be the messenger. I want you to serve. I want you to give. And that's what Jesus did. And I want to share something with you that I kind of thought about this, but he said you're supposed to serve. And the word servant here is equal to the word slave. So it's, you have no authority. You do whatever is told by you. The word servant is also used as the word deacon in the church, believe it or not. The same word as servant or slave, a deacon, one who, by virtue of office assigned to him by the church, cares for the poor and is in charge of the distribution of money and taking care of people. It's also the same word that's used for waiter that serves you. You know, you go to a restaurant, you got waiters to serve you. It's the same word. So you're serving people. Look at a waiter. They take your order, they get your order, they bring it. Are you comfortable? They make sure you have water, that you have enough food, the right knives and fork. You serve. That's what the Lord wants his disciples to do. How many of us are disciples? Now I want you to think about this. As we go through this servant type of attitude that we want to be, there's also another word used in the Word of God, and I want to share that with you. It's called bondservant. Now, everywhere in the Bible, when it says, Paul, a servant of Jesus, or James, the brother of Jesus, a servant of Jesus. Everywhere you see that word says servant, it's usually in the beginning of their letters, their epistles. That word is called bondservant. So Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? That means he freely gave up his life totally 100% to follow Jesus. And you see that in his writings, you see where he worked. Even made tents so he could make money for himself so he could continue this ministry. That's why you guys have the jobs you have right now. That's why you have the money in your pocket that you have right now so you can do the ministry that God's called us all to do. That's another subject for another time. But it's true. God gave you your skills and talents so you can raise money and funds so you can do the mission that he called us all to do, to make disciples. Baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've taught you. So that's what we're supposed to do. That's what our life is about. That's what is my purpose in life, Pastor Bob? It's to be a servant of Jesus. That's an easy answer, but the only answer and the real answer. So get your education, do a great job at work, be a great example to people in authority over you, pray for those that despitefully use you, you know, love your enemies, do all those wonderful things. But the reason you are doing what you're doing is so you can reach your cubicle mate to Jesus. That's what your purpose is. Cellmate. But we are bond service. I want to share something with you that I think will blow some of you guys' mind. Hopefully it blew my mind this week. But go to Acts chapter 2. Remember when Jesus said he'll pour out his spirit on all the people? Come on, this is for us deep thinkers, okay? Just, I want you to look at this. Deep thinkers, all my scholars in here, look at this, and I want you to examine this with me or with all of us. And even if you're not a deep thinker, God's going to pour it in you anyway. Hallelujah. I need more. I need more of him. He said, give me more, all I have to do is ask, so I want more. So he says right here, Acts chapter 2, and we're going to go to... I'll go ahead and skip this part. I'll go verse 18. Well, let's go back to Peter's address to the crowd. Okay, verse 14. Acts chapter 2, verse 14. All right, follow this with me. It says, then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let me explain to you and listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk as you suppose, but... It is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Now listen, this is a prophecy that was prophesied by Joel. Look in the Bible, in the book of Joel, you'll see the same exact words are here. It says, in the last days, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Who does that include? All people. Right? Not just the Jewish people, but all people. All right? It says, your sons and your daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women. Look at the word servant there. What is that word? Is a servant like a waiter, or is a servant as a bond servant? It says a bond servant. So what does that mean? What does that mean to us today? That means... a bond servant, if you go back to biblical times, is a slave that was in a person's home, and when they were able to be released, usually the year jubilee, they let every 7 years they let people go, they could go free, their debt was paid or whatever, they could go free. But sometimes, because the master or the person that was in charge was so nice to them that they didn't want to leave, so they said, "I want to be a bond servant. I want to be your servant." And so they would go to the doorpost, and they would take an awl, and they would just actually put a hole right through their ear, and put a ring in their ear, and they would say that. They were saying to that master that, I'm going to serve you freely now. I will do whatever you want me to do. I'll serve you. I'm here. I'm yours because you took such good care of me. How much will God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit take care of you? Come on. And then the most significant part of this is that he said that he would, but look at this, he said, even on my servants, my bond servants, those that are willing to serve me with all their heart, soul, mind, body, everything within me, those people, it says here, men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days and they will prophesy. What does that mean? I'll proclaim the good news of Jesus. I will know the voice of God. I will prophesy because I want to be. So my statement earlier today when I said in the church we're kind of weak and we're non-productive because we're not bondservants. We want to prophesy, but we can't because we're not willing to be the bondservant that God requires us to be to get the blessings that we need to do the work of his ministry. Come on, is this good stuff or not? Come on, this is what the Word of God is saying to us. Let's go deeper. Let's not just take baby food in anymore. Let's get a little bit deeper and understand that the Word of God is saying that we have to be fully committed. When we say, I surrender all, except for this, this, and this, and this, and this. I surrender all, not this, nor this, or that. All to Jesus. I surrender. No, we don't do it. We sing it, but we're not doing it. And what I want to convince you today, and I want to encourage you today, is that we need to do it all. Because the time is short, I believe. Just get a map out and look at all the stuff that's happening in the world today. And not just happening all over in the world, but all in the strategically parts of the world that has biblical references to it. I'm saying, guys, come on. I knew Israel was going to go into a war. Because I studied out the atmosphere, the blood moons that are happening. So it happened in 1967, it happened in 1948, it happened in 1472, and the same set of moons that are happening through these next 2 years, it all shows, every one of those are an example. And I shared that a while back, that the signs, the skies are, the things that happen in the skies are a sign for us. It all comes together. So I want to encourage you to be not just a servant, but a bondservant, sacrificing everything, because the master is so wonderful. Not me. Jesus is so wonderful. And he'll take care of you. He says even this, he said, I'll provide all your needs according to his riches and glory. Christian. Hey, all I have to do is ask and believe that he'll provide what I need. What do you need? You all know that our truck broke down, right? So I have a car now, as Monday I'll get a car, that I don't have to pay a penny for. Pretty cool. So Tina and I go, yes, God. We go, oh, we brokered a great deal. No, we said, yes, God. Thank you. And it's red, by the way. That's our favorite color. So we have another red car. Little car, nothing fancy, just a little four-cylinder, five-speed. That's probably why we got a good deal, because nobody wants to drive five-speed. But anyway, Elizabeth loves to drive five-speed, so she's fine with that. But you know, we got a car. We got a little car that we need. We don't want to go buy a new car. We don't want to spend money. We don't go in debt anymore. We just wanted something that we could take care of to bring him glory. And so that's what we said, yes, God, because God knows what we needed, right? And it's a simple little thing, it's not a major thing, but that's what we need. I want to be more loving. I want to love people like God loves them. I want to see the unwanted, the broken, those that are in need. I want to see them and have the compassion. That's why I've been praying for myself a lot. I want to pray. I want to be that way. I say it to you, but sometimes I'm not living it. Come on. Just me? Or we, come on, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes we look really good on a Sunday, we say all these wonderful things, but then on Monday we're just the same old prayer. No, I want you to change today. I want the Holy Spirit to ingrain in you today, into your heart, and the tablets of your heart, that we're not just servants, but we're bond servants for the Most High God. Because then we can fulfill what this prophecy prophesied in Joel, that all of us are included in. It says, even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs on earth below, blood and fire, come on. Blood moons, this is a reference to that. I mean, I just really think it is. And it's already happening. We're in the cycle of it. It's going to happen in the Feast of Tabernacles and in Passover next year and the Feast of Tabernacles in 2015. It's going to happen. NASA's already proven it. It's going to happen. So that's going to happen. It's part of being built. Before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, which is what? Before the coming, these things are going to happen. The great, glorious day of the Lord, that's Jesus' return. Come on, get excited with me. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Hallelujah. People aren't calling on the name of the Lord because we're not prophesying. The reason we're not prophesying is because we're not bond servants. Pastor Bob, you said you were going to encourage us this morning. I do. I want to encourage you to go deeper in your relationship with God. Not just this superficial American type of Christianity. I mean, I'm talking about standing before, outside your house, and getting killed because of the gospel kind of gospel that's happening in the world today. I think about that. What if they would say, they put a sword to my head and say, okay, denounce Christ. Would you denounce Christ? I'm thinking, no. Because I'll be instantly in his presence, so do what you got to do, right? Right? I'm thinking that's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, what from this realm of reality to the next is supernatural. We can't even see it, but it's right there. Why could Christians throughout time be martyred for the gospel? Their bodies ripped apart. They're cut in half. All this weird stuff that's happening right now in the world because they denounce Christ. Why? How can you do that? You can't do it unless you have the power. You can't have the power if you take the next step. And that's to be a slave, a bondservant of not a religious system, of not capital C church or the Assemblies of God or whatever denomination. That's not it. It's being a bondservant to Jesus. That's where a church messes up. That's why we're the church, the body, we the people. We're the church, not the building, not the organization, none of those things. And that's why I can say, yes, I'll be a bondservant to that, because that makes sense then. Because if I do it, if you're being a bondservant to Pastor Bob, then it's like, it's not even going to work. I'm going to fail you, and it just ain't going to work. But as a brother and sister in Christ, a family working together for King God, it's a different thing. We love each other. That's why we encourage each other to love each other more and more. But as a servant of God, oh, how I feel like I failed so many times. Hallelujah. Let's do this. Let's just everybody just close your eyes right where you're at. I want you to take a moment to confess to the Lord whatever's in your heart right now. And maybe it is like, oh Lord, I've been a good servant, but I really haven't seen this word, this bondservant word. I mean, I knew it was an Old Testament word, but now I see it in the New Testament. I see that I lack the authority because of my unwillingness to serve you wholeheartedly. Just take a moment where you're at. We're not going to, if you want to come up to the altar, you can. And kneel before God. That's appropriate. If you want prayer, I want tell them we're busy. Oh, sorry. That's my other bond servant, my son Christopher calling. Oh, to Jesus. You as our Father in Jesus, as our King, and the Holy Spirit as our messenger, as our teacher. Father, fill us with your power, fill us with your love for one another, and fill us with a mission, the boldness to preach your gospel to the world around us. Father, I thank you for these saints. I ask you to bless them. I ask you to keep them. And I thank you for their heart after you. In Jesus' precious name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.